James chapter 4, James chapter 4, beginning verse 1. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire but do not have, so you kill. You covet but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. And when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God, or against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he's caused to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. That's why the Scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning, and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. This morning we want to consider solving conflicts through true humility. There was a story of a couple who'd been married for 60 years, and throughout their life they shared absolutely everything. They loved each other deeply. They had not kept any secrets from one another except for one small shoebox. The wife kept it up on the top shelf of her closet. And when they got married, she put the box there. And she asked her husband never to look inside and never to ask questions about that box. So for 60 years, the man honored his wife's request. In fact, he kind of forgot about it after a while. His wife was growing gravely ill and was in the hospital, and the doctors knew that she was not likely to recover. So the man, remembering the box, put his wife's affairs into order. He remembered the box, he got it down, and he brought it to her at the hospital. And he asked her if perhaps now they might be able to open it after all these years. She agreed. They opened the box. Inside were two crocheted dolls and a roll of money that totaled $95,000. The man was astonished. The woman told her husband that the day before they were married, her grandmother told her that if she and her husband were to ever to get into an argument with one another, they should work hard to reconcile it first. And if they couldn't reconcile, she should simply keep her mouth shut and crochet a doll. The man was touched by this because there were only two crocheted dolls in the box. He was amazed that after 60 years of marriage, they apparently had only two conversations that they were unable to reconcile. And tears came into his eyes. And he grew even more deeply in love with this woman. Then he asked her about the roll of money. It's with this roll of money. And his wife said, "Well, every time I crocheted a doll, I sold it to the local craft fair for $5. So maybe there's a little more conflict than he realized. Truth be told, conflict is a part of our lives. In any relationship, there come times where we come to a point of disagreement, a point where a conflict develops. It's true in marriage, it's true in families, it's true in churches, it's true at work with your boss and with your coworkers, it's true in school, you remember playground, there's just, in every aspect of life, conflicts develop. On the big scale, they develop there too. This world, down through the ages, has been fighting back and forth, quarreling about this and that and the other thing. Sometimes unresolved quarrels that have gone on for centuries that continue to be a source of conflict. James asks us to step back and ask the question, where does this all come from? Why do we fight? Why do we quarrel? Whether it's the big wars on a massive scale, or whether it's the little arguments that take place in our everyday life, where do those things come from? And is there anything that we can do to help to resolve those conflicts? Well, let's take a look at the text. Probably make it brief this morning, given how my voice is responding. The source of conflict is frustrated, untamed desire. The word here is for pleasures or desire is hedone in Greek. And from that word, we get a word called hedonism. That's right. Living for pleasure. So I want more, you know, whatever pleasure it is, I want more and more. I want more and more of this and that and the other thing. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. It's kind of the attitude of the hedonist. And this word, he says, at the heart of what our problem is our own desires that battle within us. And especially the fact that those desires are frustrated. And when we get frustrated because our desire is not being met, what happens? Conflict. Conflict. It's a pretty simple principle, but very important principle. So living for our own pleasures is the source of conflict, James says. He actually uses two words for desires. The first one is hedone, the one we get the word hedonism from. The other is epithemeo, which is a word that means just desire, or it can be an evil desire or a lust. It's the most commonly described that way. And he kind of interchangeably uses those two words. Hedone is not used all that much in the New Testament. Epithemeo is used all the time. Almost every time it talks about the sinful desire within us or the lust within us, it's using that word. Here he puts the two together. And he says that we have desires that battle within us. And then later he talks about our mixed motives, and even when we pray, he says, you spend what you want on your pleasure, that you might want to spend it on your pleasures. So pleasures here is that word, hedone, and then later he uses it, the other version of it. And this is a word that's used throughout Scripture. Titus 3 says it's one of those qualities that was true of many of us before we came to Christ. He says at one time, we were foolish, we were disobedient, we were deceived, we were enslaved by all kinds of passions, and here's the word, pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. So he says, in looking at your old way of life before you were a Christian, it's very common just to live for your pleasures. I mean, that's the way the world lives. You just, I have a desire to do something. There's something I want, and I'm going to go get it. And that's the source here, he says, of conflict. But in Titus, he says that's the way, the old way of life. In Luke, Jesus uses this word hedone. It's in that story about the parable of the sowers. Remember how he sows the seed, and there's different kinds of soil. And then the one that it gets the, you know, it doesn't even go into the ground, and the bird comes and takes it away, representing Satan, and, you know, he takes it away through temptation. And then it says there's others that goes into rocky soil where it goes into, you know, there's all kinds of weeds. Well, the one that falls among the thorns is, Jesus says, stands for those who hear, but as they go on their way, they're choked by life's worries, riches, and pleasures. Same word, hedone here. And they do not mature. Sometimes when we live our life for pleasure, when we just live our life as if the only thing that really matters is what I want, it takes us down a road where we miss out on spiritual growth, where we fail to mature. It's one of the things that will choke off the Word of God in our lives and keep it from growing into the harvest that God intends. So when we live our lives just for our own selfish pleasures, you can be sure, not only will you have conflict, you will also be immature. And those two things kind of fit together pretty well, don't they? Now the cravings that he may have had in mind here, the desires, seem to be things like power and control and partisanship. There were apparently teachers who were trying to take control and teach certain things. They were bringing division within the church. But the overall principle is pretty true all the way across the board. If you want to find out what's going on with the conflicts that you're in, start looking at your motives. Start looking at your own heart. Start considering, what are my motivations and how am I just living according to my own selfish desires? James earlier said in chapter 1 that each person is tempted when they're dragged away by their own evil desire. What's temptation? We say, oh, the devil made me do it, you know, or something. We try to blame it on somebody else. Eve tries to blame it on Adam, Adam tries to blame it on Eve. And we're always blaming somebody. And James says, no, that's the way it is. It's your own evil desire. It's the hate and hate. It's those selfish desires within you. The desire for just meeting your own pleasures and wants. That's what causes trouble in our lives. And he says, when we're dragged away by our own desires, when we're enticed, then desire is conceived. It gives birth to sin. And when it's full grown, sin gives birth to death, he says. Doesn't have good consequences, clearly. These same words are used, or similar ideas are, I should say. This is actually hypothumia in most cases. But in 1 Peter, he says, as obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy, because I am holy, says the Lord. So again, conforming to evil desires against the will of God here and causes the struggle. In 1 Peter 2, he says, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires, which wage war against your soul. And one of my favorites is in 1 Peter 4, where he says, as a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. And I like this verse. You spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. They're surprised that you do not join with them in reckless, wild living, and they heap abuse on you. But they're going to have to give account to him who's ready to judge the living and the dead. So Peter, again, is recognizing that's the old life. When you weren't a believer, of course, you're going to live for your own desires and pleasures. What else is there to live for? I mean, that's what you think life is all about. And Peter says, nah, you wasted enough doing that. You wasted enough time doing that. You wasted years of your life already. Why do you want to live there anymore? Get away from that. Romans 6 tells us, to go to Pauline text, do not let sin reign in your body, your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desires. Rather, clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think how to gratify the desires of the flesh. So that's where You know, you just want to do your own thing. And he says, you have to give yourselves to God. You have to surrender yourself to him. Give the members of your body to God. That you don't just give in to your evil desires. You see, the heart of the problem here, James says, is when our desires are untamed and frustrated. He says it this way. You desire and do not have, so you kill. You covet, you can't obtain, so you fight and you wage war. See how this structure places the emphasis on the fact that frustrated desire leads to violence. Now, is this not true in your own life? Think about it. You don't get your own way. You have something you have your heart set on. And, well, maybe it's your wife or someone else comes into your wife who has a very different idea of where you ought to be focusing your attention and what you ought to be doing about things. And her desire frustrates your desire. What happens? Well, conflict, right? Struggle. Sometimes it's words that we speak back and forth. But in any case, even if it's internal, there's a conflict that begins to develop between us. It ultimately is expressed somehow. So frustrated desire, James says, is the cause of the struggles and the fights and the wars and the things that we go through in our life, whatever level those things might be on. Now, there's three things that affect those desires in an unusual way, and James points out all three of them. They're classically, I remember my dad had a book called The World, the Flesh, and the Devil. I always thought that was an interesting title for a book. But in any case, those are the three enemies that wage war and take advantage of your own desires so that you put yourself in a place where conflict develops. So there are like three things that impact your desires, that intensify them, that in some cases just kind of make them stronger and more out of control. Remember when we talked about epithymia, the lusts, I don't remember when it was, but at some point we talked about the fact that epithymia, the lusts that we have, are desires that get out of control, right? You have legitimate and good desires, but when they get out of control, they become lusts. There's just all kinds of things. You have a desire to eat, okay? You go to a buffet, and suddenly those desires are magnified.
Yeah.
As you see things, especially when you get to the dessert party, you know, it's like they're inflamed even more, and it's like, ooh, we talk about having our eyes are too big or something, bigger than our stomach, but the truth of the matter, we can give into a desire. It's a legitimate, good desire. We have to eat, but we don't have to eat everything, and we don't have to eat that chocolate cake that's right there that's so intriguing to me right at the moment. There are limits that we set on ourselves for our own health. At least we should. And lust is when it's just, I just live for my desires. I don't curb them in any way. I just go after it, whatever it might be. So how do our desires get so untamed? Like I said, it's the world, it's the flesh, and it's the devil. The world, look at verse 4. In verse 4 we read, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." It's an interesting thing. He immediately moves into this discussion of the influence of the world on us, being worldly. Now, I remember growing up, and it always amazed me how every little group of Christians has a list of things that they think describe worldliness. And And it's usually, you make up that list so that it's things that you personally don't like, and that you're pretty good at not indulging in because those aren't your particular concerns. And they're regional sometimes. I mean, you move to different areas of the country, and you'll find that there are some things that are a bigger issue, you know, down south or in the Midwest or on the East Coast, than they are in on the West Coast, especially. Especially if you go to LA, where there's not much anything, it's an issue. But you get the idea, right? I mean, we make these lists of things, and we think, well, that's what worldliness is. But in reality, it's the lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life. It's the lust of the eyes and the desires of the heart. And it's the pride that was within us. That's the way John describes it in 1 John. It's worldliness really has its genesis in our heart, in our inner life. And it's when our eyes see things and they dwell a little bit too long, and we want to covet and we want to desire something that really isn't the best thing for us. Or our heart wants something and it wants it so badly. Or we give into our own selfishness, our pride, a boastful pride of life, John says. And that's what it is. That's what worldliness is. It's not really a style so much. It's the substance of one's heart. It's the values that you have. Am I seeking to please God with all my heart and soul? Or do I just kind of, I see the way that the rest of the world is living, and I want to live the same way. I see, you know, what my neighbor is driving, and I want to drive something at least as nice as what they're driving. Or I see my neighbor down the road, and, you know, they've got a pretty nice house, and I'm going to get a big, nice house, well, maybe even a bigger house. And we do these funny games. They got a big boat, and, you know, I like a bigger boat, you know. We play these games, and we live according to the desires of our heart. The world around us fills our minds filled with ideas. I mean, advertising, a whole industry is predicated on this, that you need something newer and better. The one you bought this last week, when you went to Best Buy, it's not good enough anymore. You need something. There's a better and newer model. You know that iPhone? Every year, at least once, you need to update that thing because it's just not good enough anymore. There's some new features and some new things. And whatever it is, I mean, you buy most electronics and it's out of date by the time you take it out the door. They're, at least that's what they try to tell us. The world fills our minds with things. We talk about teenagers having peer pressure. We all have peer pressure. We all do it. We see things around us. We watch things. We hear things. We read things. And it gives us a desire for something more. The world fuels our desires. The flesh, the desires that battle within us, fuel our desires. I was just reading this little thing about the flesh, and you know how there's always this, in Scripture, there's tension between the flesh and the spirit. And Dallas Willard writes this, the conflict between the flesh and the human spirit is the conflict between desire, what I want, and the will for what is best. It's the conflict between what I want and what's best for me. And hence, it's also the conflict between desire and love, which is always directed toward what is good for its object. What does it mean to love? It means to will to good for the other person, especially agape love. So lust and love are two utterly different kinds of things. You may say you love chocolate cake, but you don't. You don't will its good, nor perhaps your own. You just want to eat it. Isn't that true? Isn't that true? We say we love things, but unless you're willing the good of that thing, you're not really loving. You may have all kinds of emotions and all kinds of feelings, but that's not what agape is all about. That's not what this true love is all about. It's to will the good of the other person. So anyway, so we got the world, we got our own desires battling within us. We have the flesh within us that say, oh, I want my own way, you know. And it's remarkably, our flesh, that within us, is remarkably unrefined and is usually unformed in the ways of Christ. It wants to do its own thing, not what God wants us to do. And if that weren't bad enough, James says, there's another influence in our life. There is a real malevolent force. There is a person in a whole evil system that's working against you. James calls it the devil. He says, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. I know, you know, 21st century, we think, you know, that was an old worldview thing. But James is saying, no, there really are forces at work trying to tempt you and to entice you and to get you off track, to influence your desires in the wrong direction and to get you to desire things that you shouldn't desire. It's not just what's in you and it's not just what's in them, the world around us, but there is also an evil person who is totally anti-Christ and every good thing, who is also at war for your soul. And you need to flee from him. So the world, the flesh, and the devil all work on your desires to make them just get out of control, unruly, and they dominate everything. Our desires can come to be so strong. And that's what leads to conflict, he said. So how do we tame desire? In the moments that remain here, how do we tame desire? I think he has an interesting plan here. I just wanted to say one thing, and that is this: we recognize that there are, when it comes to resolving conflicts, it isn't all just about you. There's usually another side to the story, right? And James here is very, very insightful in that he says the one thing you can deal with is yourself. That doesn't mean that there won't be conflict, because there are other people involved too. And he doesn't really address that part of it. There are other scriptures that do, however. There are numerous texts that talk about the importance of having the right attitude, about listening to each other, about having good communication with each other, about not allowing anger to go down, you know, don't let sun go down in your anger. These principles that you need to deal with the anger as quickly as it's humanly possible for us to deal with it. That when we have trouble with conflict over the long term, we may need to call in some help from other people to help mediate it. There's numerous other principles of Scripture that James isn't getting into here. But what he is saying is there is something everybody can do about it, and that is deal with your heart. Deal with the desire within yourself. It may not take care of everything, but it sure will go a long ways to solving the problem. And if you get two people who choose to follow James' advice, you can imagine how much easier it would be to resolve conflict. So, he says this, and it seems kind of strange that he puts it here, but I think there's a reason for it. He says, you do not have because you do not ask God. And when you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. It seems like in the middle of this discussion about conflict, he starts talking about prayer. It's like, why does he do this? Because I could do a whole sermon series on this one little verse here about asking with the right motives, about why you don't get your prayers answered because you ask with the wrong motives. I mean, there's a whole sermon waiting to be preached there someday. Not now. But what I'm asking the question is, why did he stick it here? And it seems to me that he's saying something. This is my theory. Prayer is our first means of taming and refining and purifying our inner desires. When I read through the Psalms, I see them being bluntly honest with God and laying out what's in their hearts. And then as they're in the presence of God, often their motivations change. They start out saying, "Oh Lord, you seem so far away. Are you ever going to listen? Are you ever going to answer my prayer?" And then there'll be a but. But then I remember that God is always faithful to his promises. And God, I remembered how good God has been to me all these years. And then there's hope that invades the scene. And so it is in our life when we pray. When we take our needs and our wants and our desires to God, what happens? Well, you start putting those things in his presence for long enough, and guess what happens? Your desires begin to change. You begin to see the selfish motives. You begin to see the areas where, you know, maybe I'm not doing this, I'm not wanting this for the right reason. Or maybe there's some other things that are more important than what I think needs to be done about this thing. And I know that in the heat of the moment, it might seem like, you know, you're fighting back, "Oh, look, just a minute, I need to pray about this." It would seem like a crazy solution to the problem, right? And I'm not saying that's necessarily when you do this. But I think what he's saying is that when we refine our desires through the course of a lifetime of communication with God, that he begins that process of taming us and changing us and making us more like Jesus and forming us more and more into his image and more into the mind of Christ. And that takes time and discipline and time spent in his presence. There's no doubt about that. It doesn't happen in a moment or an instant, but over time it happens. And the more we take our everything to him and lay it all on the table, it's amazing how our desires change. I think it's an insightful, it's at least one of the reasons he must have put it here. You know, while desire, even hate and hate, can be used to describe an evil desire or being driven by our desires and cravings, it also can be a good thing. There are many good desires. And at the heart of every evil desire and lustful desire is generally a good desire. And here's what I want you to realize. When we take delight in the Lord, when we take delight in him, when we take things to him and find our delight in him, he says, the scripture says that he will give you the desires of your heart. Isn't that interesting? As much as we're fighting against the desires, the selfish desires, the twisted desires, the worldly desires, those desires that come from temptation, as much as we are fighting that, those fleshly desires that keep me bound, as much as I'm fighting that, deep down within us, there is God-given good desire. And if we delight ourselves in him, the desires change. And he's able then to give us the desires of our heart. He tames and strips off and changes the desires of our life. So don't underestimate the possibility of prayer being a means to resolving conflict. I recognize it's more that it's disciplining us over the long haul. But prayer allows us to take all of our needs and desires to God. And in the process, he moderates and sanctifies and purifies our desires, the desires that remain generally reflect a good and noble desire that's worth pursuing. But much will be stripped off in the process, without a doubt. The second thing I think James tells us is this: grow in the grace of humility. Want to ward off unnecessary conflict in your life? Grow in the grace of God, and especially his benefit of humility. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So says James. Now, he's not the only one who said that. He's quoting scripture there, I think. But in any case, this principle is true. So look at verse 6. But he gives us more grace. That's why Scripture says God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. He's the one who exalts. He's the one who lifts us up. When we try to do it ourselves, we always get it wrong. It always messes everything up. Pride goes before a fall. Pride gives us all kinds of trouble. It's at the heart of our problem, actually. And God opposes it. But he gives us grace. Grace, all that we need. All the power and strength and resources that we need to live a life of humility. Which replaces that pride. So how do we get there? It seems to me, well, here's what he says. First thing is you got to submit yourself to God. He says, submit yourself, verse 7, then to God. Submit yourself to God. Paul said this numerous times. Romans 12, 1. You remember he talks about the transformation that takes upon us by the renewing of our mind? He says that we should give ourselves to God as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship, he says, from Romans 12, 1 to 2. There's a surrender of ourselves to God. We ourselves become the sacrifice. We give ourselves completely to God. If we submit to God, in Romans 6, Paul talks about how we have to give our members of our body to God. Offer them to God. The parts of our body. So that we don't give in to sin. But that we discipline ourselves. And God graces us by his Spirit. In order that we might live for him in a way that pleases him. But ultimately it's a matter of surrendering who we are. Even the parts of our bodies to him. So that we don't sin against him. Submit yourself and your members to God. That's what he says first. And then he says, number two, resist the devil. And it's great what it says. Resist the devil, and he runs. He flees from you. Now, if you don't, guess what? He sticks around. He gives you a hard time. You got to run. You need to resist. And Paul says, we need to stand in the armor of God. He says, having done everything, let us stand firm in the armor of God. He says, we live in a spiritual battle zone. And the real battle isn't what we see with our eyes, but a battle that goes on among the powers and the authorities and the evil forces, the dark powers that are at work in this world. And whether we like to realize that or not, he says, there is a real spiritual battle, and there's a real enemy for your soul, and you need to stand firm in all that God has given you in Christ. The helmet of salvation, and the breastplate of righteousness, and the belt of truth buckled around your waist, and your feet fitted with the preparation of the gospel of peace, that is shield of faith, and take that sword of the Spirit. Pray with all kinds of prayers and requests. So we're in battle. Spiritual battle. Resist him. And guess what? He's going to run. He's going to run. Come near to God. Develop your intimacy with God. Develop your relationship with him. Through prayer. Through reading his word. Through other disciplines like practicing the presence of God. You ever try just to, as you go from place to place during the day, no matter what you're doing, recognize that I'm in the presence of God. There's a great little book by a guy named Brother Lawrence. He was a monk, and he used to wash dishes. And he talked about how he learned to practice the presence of God. Remember that God was with him, especially as he was washing dishes. I don't know, but I kind of found that that's actually not a bad place to pray. Those meaningless little things that we do sometimes. In any case, come near to God. I've been reading about Moses and how he just had such a desire to be with God. And, you know, show me your glory, God. And he would go into the tent of meeting, and he would, you know, there's so many interesting stories about intimacy with God. And then the last one is repentance and confession and tears and grieving and wailing and mourning. I mean, that's kind of a strange little verse, but what's he talking about here? These are times of repentance. When Israel got far from God, what did they do? They called a fast. They put on sackcloth and ashes, and they would weep, they would grieve and wail and mourn, and they would seek God and they would pray. And over the course of time, God would hear, and he would bring them back to their home country and revive and refresh and restore them as a people. And so throughout the human history, into the New Testament era, we find these times of revival that have taken place when God's people got serious about sin and they got on their faces before God and they would grieve and wail and mourn and seek God and say, "Oh God, we're far from you. We need you now." And submit yourself to God. Resist the devil. Come near to God. Repent. Turn from your sinful ways. Get on your face before God. Make sure you're right with him. And guess what? That's where the fear of the Lord comes. That's where the rightful awe and reverence comes. When we get on our knees before him, when we humble ourselves before him, and guess what happens? God gives us the grace of humility. And what happens to those who are humble? When the time is right, God lifts them up. When the time is right, God exalts the humble. So as you submit, resist, come near, repent, confess, weep, find revival in your own heart, you're finding the grace to humble yourself before the Lord so that he can lift you up. Humility will also lead us to not strike back and slander, verse 11, and will not allow us to judge our neighbor, verse 12. That remains God's job, not ours. So while there are many other biblical principles about resolving conflicts, James is insightful to us because he says, at the heart, there is something that everyone can do. You can't change the other person. It doesn't work. God's got to change their heart. But you can do what you can do, and that's in your heart. Deal with the motive. Deal with the issue. Deal with the desire. And the desires that battle within us, the real problem, are those frustrated, untamed desires. So ironically, the conflict that leads to all other conflicts is the conflict within us. The desires battling within us. And if we can find peace through taming those desires, we'll be in a place to be a peacemaker who sows a harvest of righteousness. Well, let's pray. Lord, I do pray that you would just work in our hearts and make us a people who want to do what we can do in our own hearts and lives to live in humility and to take our needs and wants and desires to you and find peace and contentment and joy in you. I pray, Lord, that we would find our hope in you. And I pray, Lord, that you would just work at refining and changing those desires and making them pure and holy and noble desires. That the desires of our heart would be the desires of your heart. And that you could pour out your grace, humble us so that we be people that walk in your humility, in your love, and seek the good of the other through that love. And in so doing, perhaps reduce the potential for conflict in our life. And Lord, we know there are other aspects of it as well, but help us to deal with our own heart first. And we pray in Jesus' name. So I think.